CROI 2014, Dr. Ronald Valdiserri spoke with Dr. Doug Dieterich of Mount Sinai Hospital.
Hello, this is Dr. Ron Valdiserri, and I'm reporting from the 2014 Conference on Retrovirus and Opportunistic Infections in Boston, and we're very honored to have with us Dr. Doug Dieterich, who is a liver specialist from Mount Sinai Hospital in New York. And actually, Dr. Dieterich has presented some very groundbreaking information at this meeting. But what I want to ask you, Dr. Dieterich, if I might, what would you want to tell primary care providers about what's happening in the field of hepatitis C treatment today?
Well, I think there's a couple of take-home messages that are really important for the primary care people to understand. Number one, the size of the epidemic. I think as the CDC and the USPSTF have pointed out, it may be as many as 5 million or more people in the U.S., and 75% of them don't know they have it. So we need to get them tested. And the primary care people have a really huge role in testing those people for hepatitis C.
And we now, if I can pause now, you might want to share with the viewers that we now have both the CDC and the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force saying the same thing about screening for hepatitis C. And what is that message?
Right. The message is screen all baby boomers born between 1945 and 1965.
And just to be clear, this means the provider does not have to elicit a risk history. This is based on age.
Absolutely, based on age. And frankly, I don't even ask about risks. It's like, I don't care how you got it, because some people feel guilty, you know, they don't want to be.
And some don't want to share it.
And some don't want to tell you, actually, the things they did that back in the Woodstock generation got them hepatitis. I don't care. Who cares? It's like, they have it. It's like hypertension. It's like, it's not their fault.
You want to take care of it. You want to diagnose it and take care of it.
Well, and that's the other point, actually. We can cure it. We don't just take care of it, Rod. We cure it.
Perfect.
We cure it. So when we cure it, it's gone. And the liver disease in the vast majority of patients gets better. So that's a huge
It's a huge
thing.
Difference with HIV or other types of infections that we can treat but not cure.
Right. And actually, it's not just a liver disease anymore, actually. And that's another message that the primary care treaters really, I think, should understand. There's been three big studies published now. The VA study with 400,000 patients. The Amsterdam study and the REVEAL study from Taiwan all showed all-cause mortality, that is diabetes, heart disease, cancer, everything else, was doubled in patients who had hepatitis C. So it's not just a liver disease. It's a chronic inflammatory condition that we need to cure and get rid of, because if we do that, then we can bring their mortality back down to that of the baseline.
Good. So I know that you're a world-class expert in these issues. I'm going to ask you a very basic question I'd like you to answer for the audience. I know, let's say 2 years ago even, a lot of providers shied away from treating hepatitis C because of the need to use interferon. Can you talk generally about where the field is headed, particularly in terms of interferon-free treatments, and why that's so important, not only for providers, but for patients?
Yeah, well, actually, it's important for everybody, even payers, because it turns out to be cheaper.
Good.
You know, as well. Yes, as of December 6th, we got two new drugs approved in the U.S. 2 weeks before that, simiprevir, and December 6th, sofosbuvir. Both of them are one pill once a day. Sofosbuvir is approved for genotype 2 and 3, just one pill once a day with ribavirin, and it cures 80 to 90% of genotype 2, 3 with either 12 or 24 weeks of treatment. No injections, no interferon, and virtually no side effects. I mean, that's extraordinary from where we've been with the interferon and, of course, our last level of drugs with telaprevir and bosaprevir and the side effects that we had with those. For genotype 1 and 4, the harder ones, it's recommended in the label to use it with interferon for 12 weeks, which is not so bad. It's doable. But there's new guidelines put out by the AASLD, IDSA, and IASUSA together that suggest we could use it off-label, and we are actually using it off-label quite a bit now, with simiprevir. So one pill of cimeprivir, one pill of sofosbuvir, with or without ribavirin. You don't necessarily need it. Cures somewhere between 90 and 100% of people who take that for 12 weeks. And that's extraordinary. So, you know, I'm almost not using interferon at all, now, only for a rare genotype 4. So it's really hard to get my patients in New York to take interferon for any reason, frankly, at this point. And on the horizon in the fall, we have two extraordinary, you know, compounds coming, the Gilead fixed dose combination, one pill once a day for all genotypes. That's just genotype 1.
Okay.
And the AbbVie combo, which is 3 pills a day, which cures, we just saw that presentation, 99% of people in 12 weeks.
So the short version of that is that the treatments are getting a lot better and they're getting shorter and easier to tolerate
virtually
patients.
Zero side effects.
Okay. So what would you tell, I'm going to ask you now, you talk to patients day in and day out in your job, but what would you tell to persons who might be watching this blog who perhaps are living with hepatitis C and haven't taken advantage of these treatment options? What would you say to them? What kind of conversation should they have with their provider?
Well, you know, what I typically say to the patients when they come in holding their blood tests in their hand and a little teary-eyed and gloomy and depressed, what I tell them is, it's a really good time to have hepatitis C. Okay, if you have to have it, now is the time to have it, because, you know, we've got these marvelous drugs. We can treat you right now without side effects, if necessary. If there's no rush, we can wait till the fall when it's going to be even easier, actually, and more likely to succeed. And then this time next year, we'll have another round of drugs that are available. So it's a really good time to have hepatitis C.
One last question, and this is something that in the field of HIV, we've heard a lot about for the last 5 years, and that's treatment as prevention. With hepatitis C, I know there have been several studies that have looked at this in terms of modeling it. In other words, they're not actual real experiments, but people saying if we did this, maybe that would happen. But namely, the issue of if we can treat, especially in people who inject drugs, if we can successfully treat hepatitis C, not only are we helping that patient live a healthier life, but we might actually interrupt transmission. I wonder if you have any initial thoughts on that. I know we're just at the beginning of that in the hepatitis field.
With hepatitis, it's a little more complicated than with HIV because you can get it again. And actually, we have seen reinfections. And frankly, the other group that's subject...
So after cure...
You can get
it
again.
You can be reinfected if you're re-exposed.
Yeah. Okay. It does not provide lifelong immunity.
Okay. Good, you know, good important point for people to know.
Yes, exactly. Because you can't say, oh, now I'm fine. I can go out and do whatever
exactly.
I want. You can't do that. The other group that's actually getting a lot of acute hepatitis C and reinfection is the man who have sex with men. Actually, acute hep C in men who have sex with men who are practicing unsafe sex again.
Yes.
You know, it's back. And we just came from a session on that.
Absolutely.
Right now. And so that's a big issue. So, but if we treated all those men, absolutely all of them, we could eradicate the virus, but that would be a big, you know, a big hurdle.
You just mentioned two or three really important prevention messages for people who are watching this. Number one, that being exposed to hep C and cured does not confer immunity, a very important prevention message. And the other one is that we know that from the CDC, we know that most cases of hepatitis C in the United States are related to exposure to infected blood, whether that's from a past or current history of injection drug use or exposure in a healthcare setting. But
Or maybe even a little intranasal.
Or cocaine. Intranasal, very good point, using instruments to take cocaine. As you know, historically, sexual transmission was always played down for hepatitis C because it wasn't a very frequent cause of transmission. But as you pointed out at this meeting, we're hearing that for some populations, men who have sex with men, there's more concern about the potential for sexual transmission. True?
Yeah, absolutely right. And you're absolutely correct, too, that heterosexual transmission is virtually zero. You know, it's really...
Through heterosexual
vaginal sex.
Yeah.
Anal sex is another issue, and that's the issue with men who have sex with men. But it's not even just anal sex. It's toys, it's rough sex, it's booty bump, you know, bumping. It's, you know, it's other things that go on. Yeah. And actually, it's methamphetamine at the same time.
Yes.
So sometimes they're snorting it. Sometimes they're injecting the methamphetamine along with all the other
sexual practices. So these are all unhealthy practices.
They're all very unsafe practices.
So we definitely want to focus on the importance of prevention. Well, let me just say that it's been a pleasure talking with you, Dr. Dieterich.